My next guest has been in the journalism racket for a long time, covering everything from court cases to sports to, most recently for the Globe and Mail, the war in Afghanistan. Her book about that war is called 15 Days, Stories of Bravery, Friendship, Life and Death from Inside the New Canadian Army. One of the quotes from the dust jacket is from Don Cherry, of all people, who says, among other things, and I'm quoting here, "It's a tough book written by a tough broad who tells it like it is." Christie Blatchford joins me in the studio. Thanks for coming in. I figured you'd use that quote just for that one sentence.
Well, I loved it. I think it's sort of a working class book, and I wanted a guy who connected with ordinary people.
Before we talk about some of the contents in it, I want to ask you about the writing of the book, because you've said a lot about how hard this was for you to do on a number of levels, not just because of the emotional impact of what's in it, which is significant, but also because you figured you didn't know how to write a book.
You were having
a hard time.
I didn't know how to write a book. I spent, several weeks spinning my wheels trying to write the introduction, because as a newspaper reporter, you start at the beginning and you go from there. And all the books that I read had introductions first. So I tried that, and I would work at it very hard, and I'd get about 2,000 words done and go to bed and wake up the next morning and gag.
And because this is crap.
Because it was crap. It was all about me, and that's not what I wanted to write. So finally I got some help from some friends of mine. So.
How did you decide to do it? Because we were talking just before we started here, you said, that I was going to ask you about three different days of the 15 days you've got in here, but I was going to, unlike you, ask you about them in chronological order, because you didn't do anything in chronological order. But how did you map it out? How did you plan it out in your head?
Well, thank you for assuming I had a plan. What I did was, the first chapter is about a battle on August the 3rd, 2006, and some tiny bit of that story I told my running friends at one of their houses early one morning, where we always meet. And I made them cry, so I knew that the story was probably good and compelling. So when I asked for their help in how to write the book, they told me to get some brown paper and put all the things from that day I wanted to get, and I could at least have this piece of finished writing. So I did that, and when I finished it, I realized that that was a pretty good sort of template for the rest of the book. So I then picked a number of days, and originally I think I had over 20, and then I whittled it down to a number that I thought was manageable, that I knew a fair bit about and had already researched a lot. And also, I liked the sound of the way 15 rolled off my tongue. I mean, it's a stupid reason. And I wrote them as they came to me. I mean, August 3rd was very fresh to me because I talked to so many guys about it. And I sort of did the days that came easiest, and then I mixed in some, but were also the hardest.
Yes.
I mean, they were the easiest because I'd done a lot of work on them, hard emotionally. So it has no rhyme or reason.
I'm so glad that you, I should have said at the beginning of this interview that there should be a parental advisory on this interview, because there are going to be words in it that aren't normally spoken on this program, but they're in the book and we're going to use them anyway.
One of the soldiers I know, after he read it, said the only piece of work he's ever read that was so profane was something written by somebody with Tourette's syndrome.
Okay.
So
I'm going to start by, and this is just to set things up, and I was so glad that you said this at the beginning, and I'm so glad you had this little glossary of terms at the end, because one of the things that always messes me up when I'm reading about military stuff is that it's a world full of acronyms. They have an acronym for everything.
That don't need an acronym.
That's right. They don't. Yeah. I mean, you at one point, I think it's probably in here, when you're talking about the difference between someone who's a CO, and I think we all know that would be commanding officer, or someone who's an OC, which is an officer commanding.
Yeah.
It's Python-esque.
It is, and it's just, as I think I say in there, it's one of the ways that the military likes to screw around with civilians' heads by, messing it up here.
As you're right, in the hope that despairing civilians will bleed from the ears and give up trying to make sense of it.
Yeah.
And many of us do.
And I nearly did several times, too.
All right. You quoted early on in the book, you said you always remember a guy that you met when you were picking your visa up. You said you traveled you traveled from New Delhi into Kabul, and you're picking your visa up, and this guy said, "Always remember, you can never buy an Afghan, only rent him. And as long as you pay the rent on time, no one offers a better rent, things will be fine."
Yeah, pretty good description, actually. And, he said it half admiringly, as I repeated half admiringly, because these are people who have had to live by their wits for 30 years with a variety of foreigners coming into their country, and this is how they've survived.
Yeah.
So.
All right, let's talk about April 22nd, one of your 15 days in here, because part of that day, you're writing about this fellow, Bill Turner, and he was the guy who had to replace the guy who I think everybody in this country remembers this story, this fellow Trevor Green, who was killed with the axe by the guy who just, he was sitting there with his helmet off.
He was badly injured. He should have been killed.
He was badly injured, you're right. He wasn't killed. In fact, he's, as you say, he's still recovering.
But he's doing quite well, and there was a story in the Star about a week ago about him.
Yeah. Anyway, that horrific story. Yeah. But so this guy, Bill Turner, was the guy who had to replace him as the civilian-military cooperation guy. Explain what that is exactly.
Well, that's another hideous acronym for what is actually a pretty lovely job. Civil-military cooperation are the guys, and they're exclusively reservists, so they're double volunteers.
Yeah.
And they are the guys charged, really, with relationship building in Afghanistan. Now, all the soldiers do some of this, and some do more than others. Yeah. But these guys, that is their sole job.
Hearts and mind stuff.
Yeah, so they do the negotiating. You know, when the Canadian vehicles ding a mud wall on the way in and knock it half to pieces, it's these guys who go in and talk to the locals and sit on the dusty squares, just like Trevor Green was doing when he was axed in the head. And they have the meetings and, you know, get to know people. And they do a terrific job. And Bill Turner and Trevor Green were the two CIMIC officers for Alpha Company of the Princess Patricia's Canadian Light Infantry. And Trevor was hurt in March, and that left Bill Turner, who was a mailman with Canada Post in Edmonton.
Yeah.
And he was left to do the job. And, I mean, I think the major of the company, Kurt Gallagher, you know, almost expected that Bill would be a little less keen to do it, given what happened to Trevor, but in fact he wasn't. He kept on doing his job, he kept on taking off his helmet. I met him and spent a day with him in late March, watched him work. He was, you know, 45 years old, already had a pretty accomplished life, and anyway, sorry if I'm rattling.
That's all right.
So he's working his bones off, and he's getting skinnier and skinnier, and Gallagher, the major, starts to worry about him, that he needs a bit of a break. They've been stuck up at this hideous little place called Gumbad, which was a forward operating base. They tried to get him out on helicopter, couldn't do it, and he ended up hitching a ride from Gumbad back to Kandahar Airfield with General Dave Fraser's personal protection team.
And he said before he went, he said that he didn't feel right doing it, right?
He didn't either. He felt safest with the particular platoon that he'd been working with. Mm. And I forget now if it was one platoon or not.
It was one platoon. I thought I have it right here. Yeah, one platoon.
And he didn't like to go anywhere without them. And I know how that feels, you know, because you go through some close scrapes with these guys, and suddenly you don't want to be with anyone else because you feel that you'll be jinxing yourself somehow.
Yeah.
And he did actually say something to that effect to a couple of guys. But anyway, it was his way out, his way to get back to, you know, some creature comforts and a bit of a rest. So the problem is there were only two ways in and out of this base, though I didn't realize that till I was back in Canada, which means the bombers had a pretty good chance every time they planted an IED of getting someone. And they head out of Gumbad, and I think it was pretty early in the day. There was an enormous bomb. They were traveling in a G-wagon. It was a hideous, nightmarish scene. Three of them were killed instantly, including Bill Turner.
Mm-hmm.
Another fellow, I think, hung on for a time anyway. And the thing that is, you know, that really speaks to the character of the Canadian soldier, in my view, is what happened at that scene. Because Justin McKay, who's a warrant officer, was in charge, and he's the first to get to the scene, and he looks and he knows immediately what a devastating effect this will have on his young troops. So he has all of his soldiers do what's called an all-round defense around the scene. It's like a crime scene, basically. But they
face out.
So their backs are to the worst.
Yeah.
And Justin McKay and some of his more senior soldiers then do the cleanup. And it was a dreadful cleanup, but at least he spared. And at that moment, he thought of others, you know. I think that's incredible.
Yeah. You quote Justin McKay saying that he got flack from someone back at CAF, Kandahar Airfield, because he was calling them in as a priority four, which means they're either dead or they're wounded and they can walk, but usually it means that they're dead.
Yep.
And somebody was giving them flack because they couldn't say that unless a medical officer had confirmed it.
Had pronounced death.
And he was standing in the midst of the parts of these guys.
That's right. He was. But that's a classic Army story, you know, where the guys on the ground do the right thing and the knobs back somewhere else in perfectly safe circumstances don't understand it. That's just...
Yeah.
That happens in every field of life, too.
I was reading through this stuff, and I said to you before, I couldn't read it without tears in my eyes, because this stuff is just unbelievable. And I think that the value in this is no matter how you feel about what's going on in Afghanistan and whether we should be there or not, the value in knowing what these guys are going through, because it is just stunning. I mean, that's just one story. Yeah. Tell me a little bit about the July 8th, 9th weekend.
Sure.
Because this one, as I mentioned to you earlier, too, there's footage of these of this particular battle on YouTube, put there by, I think, by a military cameraman.
Yeah.
There are three different films that people can go and see. Talk about what happened that weekend.
Sure. It was part of a fairly big exercise to go into the Panjwayi area, where Canadians have been many times since and before. I was embedded with Charlie Company, but it was Alpha, Bravo, and Charlie were all involved. So it was a big move. And we left, I think, just before or just after midnight on a Friday night. We weren't more than an hour out of the base when we started being attacked. I, fortunately, was so stupid that inside the vehicle, I mean, I can't tell incoming from outcoming. Mm. I couldn't tell what was happening, but I knew it was dodgy. Fortunately, I was listening to a Newfoundlander talk, so I was mildly distracted.
This would be Keith Mooney.
Yes. Right. And we were attacked. We fought our way basically to Pashmul, this part of the district that we were going to. I think we got there and it calmed down in the early morning hours, 3 or 4 or something, grabbed a couple hours sleep, woke up the next morning, went out with Bill Fletcher, the major, saw my first dead Taliban bodies. And then I have no idea what I did for the rest of the day because my notebook is empty. I know the soldiers went out and continued to fight. They were in a fight all day. There was a bomb that dropped way too close. I didn't even hear about the bomb until I got back to Canada. I mean, that's how either stupid or shocked or both that I was.
Yeah.
Just sat in the lav being afraid. I found my balls, as it were, by the next morning and went out with the soldiers again. This was just supposed to be a sort of peaceable kind of thing, and it was a spectacularly beautiful morning, as it often is in Afghanistan. And about 5 o'clock in the morning, they go through these grape fields, which are like trench systems,
yes,
basically, looking for evidence of enemy.
They asked you if you wanted to come along, right?
Because yes,
they were going to sweep the grape fields.
They were going to sweep the grape fields. It was going to be simple. I'd be back in an hour. And by this time, I guess I was calm. And I don't recall panicking, but I was at least internally calm.
Yeah.
So I went out with them. I didn't even bring my pack because I didn't think I'd be gone that long. And then we started taking fire. And, of course, firemen run into fires and soldiers run to fire. So they started running. And because I had no alternative, not because I was particularly brave, I didn't know my way out, so I followed them. And
yes,
for the next 9 hours, we were in a firefight.
You followed Keith Mooney?
I followed Keith Mooney.
Until you lost him?
Until I lost him. Mm-hmm. And when I lost him, he got in some trouble, as the book explains. There was a secondary explosion of a Taliban weapons cache, and he was struck in the upper thighs by by the shrapnel and thought he'd lost his baby makers.
As yes. Are as they all right? It. He's yelling.
He's like, are they all right, boys? Are they all right? And his mates thought he was asking after them.
Yeah.
And, of course, he was asking after his privates. And all was fine, as it turned out. But in the middle of all that, I think it was before 9 o'clock in the morning, they were going into one of these beautiful grape-drying huts, which are made of mud, like everything in this part of the country, but perforated like pegboard. You know, they're mm-hmm. gorgeous, tall. They were clearing one of these things, and they heard somebody chambering a weapon.
That just amazed me. They heard the shell going into the...
Yeah.
God, that's incredible. They knew that there was somebody there.
They heard the chambering of the weapon from the roof. Immediately, all took cover, including Tony Beneka, who was a reservist from Thunder Bay. But he was unlucky. It appears that what it was a deflection.
A ricochet. Yeah.
And a bullet went in just above the top part of his bulletproof vest, went in his throat, and they carried him out moments later on a rubbery black stretcher back to a medical point. And I followed them as they did that, actually walking in his blood, you know. Yeah.
This kid was 20, 21?
I think he was 21,
yeah. All right, last one I want to ask you about is September 3rd and the story of Will Cushing. Because there are two Cushley, sorry, there are two Wills actually in
there
this
are.
Story. But tell me about this young man.
There's a great picture of Will in there where he spent the summer before. He was with the Royal Canadian Regiment, 1st Battalion. Just turned 21, I think, in July that year, and would have left, I guess. Anyway, I may have the dates wrong now because it's all a mess of mine. But he just turned. He just had his 21st birthday. Spent that summer, according to his friends, took out a $4,000 loan, spent $2,000 on tattoos, and you can see some of his new tattoos in the picture, and $2,000 on beer. So he had a good summer. And then with his friend, Will Needham, and many other friends, Will Cushley had an awful lot of friends, went over to Kandahar, and exactly a month to the day after the big battle for the Patricias on August the 3rd, on September the 3rd in 2006, in the very same area, because this is the nature of that war, four members of the RCR were killed, and Will Cushley was one of them. And I didn't know him at all before this happened, but I have since got to know his mom and dad quite well. And
they're quite amazing people.
They're incredibly amazing people. And the interesting thing is, since I wrote the book, I just learned this, but Elaine Cushley is going to Kandahar herself to work in the Tim Hortons.
Really?
That's
incredible.
Lots of moms and I know three mothers who are going one way or another back to Afghanistan to be in the place where their kids were killed, and to just sort of sorry.
That's okay. It's hard. It's hard to read. And you know these people.
Yeah,
they did. He left for them, and this is the thing that got me in the book. This is the thing that brought me to where you are right now. Actually, they found his valise. Mm-hmm. In the lav that he was killed in, and it was untouched, and in it were letters.
Yeah.
And they were letters to his mom and to his dad.
Yep.
And to his three girlfriends.
Yeah, in his whole life.
Three girlfriends. They were the letters that, in case he didn't make it back, these were the final letters.
Yeah.
And so they all got those letters. And those are the most moving things.
Yeah, they are, because, they think that Will wrote those. He'd had some real combat experience already, and then got back to Kandahar Airfield, which is where it's safe. And they think he wrote them just before he went out on this last mission for him, which was the last mission, because they talked to him on the phone, too, and Elaine says his voice had changed. She could tell that he'd seen, his greatest concern was that would he rise to the occasion?
Yeah, they wouldn't measure up.
That he wouldn't measure up. And I heard that from a lot of soldiers, and he measured up. And his father, I think, is consoled by the notion that Will at least knew that he had the right stuff and hadn't failed.
Well, if your publishers will give us the okay to use some of these pictures on screen during this interview, we will, because there is one of them of Will Cushley and his dad when he's getting on the bus to leave.
I know.
And that one is, describe it, and hopefully we can show it.
It's a picture of Will and his dad at the bus, and actually there are two soldiers in that picture who were killed, Mark Graham from Hamilton was also killed. And Will is standing with his dad, and they're all these sweet young kids. I mean, Elaine says, they look like they're going off on a school trip, and
they're
they
kids,
do.
They're
babies. And Will's standing with his old man, and when Errol got the pictures developed later, he realized that he was in the sun and Will was in shadow, and it gave him such a creepy feeling,
It is an absolutely amazing book, Christie. Congratulations on it, despite all the hassle that you went through to put it together. I think it's worth it, and I think that anybody who's interested in what's going on in Afghanistan should read this, because it gives you a different perspective on what those guys are doing.
Well, thanks very much. They're a great bunch of guys.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
Thank you. Yeah.